We are expecting a total of 6 inbound and 6 outbound flights over the course of today.
We have to reopen to get more Bahamians back to work.
Taxi drivers don't have any complaints because they realize that we are still in a pandemic.
I'm Akash Lapinder, and welcome to the morning edition. A stalled travel period comes to an end today as the Bahamas officially opens its borders to the international community in a huge push to jumpstart a local economy that has been badly bruised by the COVID-19 crisis. Across the board, revenues are down and expenditure soars as unemployment rises, with thousands here at home out of work. July 1st also proving a big day for taxi drivers, as well as public and private bus services were also back on the road in what many have termed a new norm. And it goes without saying that intense planning and preparation will be put to the test this morning as Nassau Airport development officials ready themselves to welcome several hundred passengers aboard the first set of commercial flights to the Lyndon Pinckney International Airport since its closure due to COVID-19 this past March. The first to touch down will be a Delta flight from Atlanta. Here's NAD's Vice President of Marketing and Commercial Development, Jan Knowles, on what's expected.
Inbound and 6 outbound flights over the course of today. All of the flights are from the U.S. The number of daily flights to Nassau actually increases to 10 beginning on July 3rd, and it is projected to increase to 29 flights a day by August. Passengers can expect to have their temperature taken with thermal handheld devices as they disembark the plane. Any passenger with an elevated temperature would be referred to the Public Hospital Authority's surveillance nurses who are on site at the airport. All arriving passengers will have to wear masks upon arrival, and for admittance into the country by Bahamas immigration officers. Immigration officials will also verify confirmations related to health visas. We wish to remind the public that only ticketed individuals and employees are allowed in the airport terminals. Exceptions, of course, will be made for minors traveling alone, elderly persons, and persons with disabilities that require assistance.
Now, as you just heard, an assessment team down at LPIA is ensuring all goes well on the health side of things. The overall idea to minimize the prospect of COVID-19 entering the country. As Deputy Chief Medical Officer Dr. DeLon Brennan explained to us, a lot of checking is really done before travelers actually enter the Bahamas. That includes supplying health and tourism officials with crucial information, like where they're coming from, where they're headed, if they've had the appropriate PCR COVID-19 testing done.
However, at the point where people actually come into the Bahamas, having passed that part of it, we have at Lyndon Pinckney International Airport, we have our team of nurses available. The team is not just made up of health personnel, it's made up of immigration personnel as well, it's made up of tourism personnel. So what really happens is that when persons land, they will then come to immigration. They will present their paperwork to say, I have a health visa, so I've been authorized to travel to the Bahamas. I have my test results that have been checked ahead of time, but I also have them in person with me as well. And then, once they present those, if there's any challenge with those, if someone ascertains that they don't feel as though they're legitimate, or if there's a concern specifically, or they may do random checks, that's when they call in the health personnel in order to do checks with that person to make sure things match up with what they've said.
Dr. Brennan assuring that this means not everyone coming in needs to be checked for COVID-19. In the event, though, that someone has symptoms suggestive of COVID-19, here's what happens next.
if they have shortness of breath, if they have, you know, muscle aches, they appear fatigued and tired, then they will go on to a secondary screening process. We have an isolation procedure and an isolation facility at the airport, at Lyndon Pinning International Airport, in order to do those screenings as well. However, what we do know is persons aren't just coming into New Providence. They're going to our family islands and the like as well. So we have the same procedure in place in our family islands as well. Our family island personnel, immigration, customs, healthcare personnel are to identify a particular location where where the expectation is that they will let the person know that we see that you have symptoms, we're concerned about your health, and we're going to have our healthcare personnel evaluate you, and they would put them into that isolation location until healthcare personnel are able to do so.
The Atlantis Paradise Island Resort not taking any chances. The virus's alarming resurgence in America has prompted officials at the multi-million dollar mega resort to shift its phased reopening from July 7th to July 30th. The Prime Minister making that announcement in the House of Assembly Tuesday afternoon following a discussion with Atlantis executives. A local mega resort, Bahama, reducing its staff meantime. While resort officials did not give an exact amount, we understand it will be a significant number. Now, in a statement, Bahama officials say in preparations to reopen in the fall, they made the difficult but necessary decision to implement staffing reductions to adequately align with projected business levels. According to the company, as the 90-day period ended on June 29th, it was necessary to take the incredible difficult step of reducing staff across Grand Hyatt, SLS, Rosewood, Malaya, Casino, and Bahama Shared Services. Officials add that they are in the process of communicating directly with each of the employees, and all affected associates will receive severance pay in accordance with the law. Officials adding that for an additional 90 days, Bahama will continue to support all remaining associates by ensuring each receives 30% of their base compensation and will also pay for the insurance premiums necessary to maintain associates' health insurance, life and accidental death and dismemberment insurance coverage. In light of this recent development, our news team spoke with Labor Director John Pinder.
I didn't get an exact number of how many persons are affected by that, but we understand that there's quite a number of persons that would be affected by that. We were hoping that the extension the government granted the employers would have sufficed the employers and given sufficient time to start to get their business up and running again with a view of opening when the international borders open and when the cruise line starts to return to the Bahamas again. But there's no clear indication as to when that's going to happen due to the increase in numbers of cases in the United States, in particularly Florida and some of the northern part of the United States, where we depend on the number of our tourists to come from. And I guess as a result of that, Bahama sees it fit to make the necessary choice of giving separation packages.
They also addressed unemployment benefits for the group.
I know the government has extended the grace period from the 12 weeks, gave them an additional 30 days, would have expired come July 30th or the end of July. And there's talks about even further assistance to persons all the way to October. And I think that was with a view of trying to ensure that business would have commenced by that time and the hotel properties would have started to receive bookings in advance of that time to be able to keep their doors open and to bring the staffers back to work.
It could be quite busy today as bus drivers return to the streets. That and more when the Morning Edition returns.
Listen, when you're getting some gas at the gas station, when you're shopping at your favorite grocery store, how you know you're getting exactly what it is that you pay for. BBSQ, the the Bahamas Bureau of Standards and Quality. Now, they got a team of professionals trained and working all the time to ensure quality and safety of goods and services. They are doing something called metrology.
Metrology works to protect consumers from receiving inaccurate quantities of goods purchased unmeasured and to protect sellers from delivering excess amounts of goods due to the use of inaccurate measuring instruments.
They have equipment to go in the stores and gas stations all over the Bahamas.
What do we use to verify the accuracy of volume at your favorite gas station, you may ask? A test measure. This is a volumetric standard used to verify gas, diesel, and other liquid dispensing devices.
They use the weight to ensure the scale is reading properly.
Now, when it comes to grocery stores, we use these mass standards. These are specialized equipment used to verify that instruments like weighing scales are accurate.
BBSQ is making sure that the consumers are getting their money's worth and that the businesses are getting treated fairly. Because of the work BBSQ does behind the scenes and in the field, quality is a guarantee.
The Ministry of Social Services and Urban Development, Department of Social Services, presents a list of 2020 official hurricane shelters. North Abaco, Faith Walk Church of God Community, Cooperstown. South Abaco, Moores Island All-Aid School, Moores Island. Sandy Point Community Center, Ernest Dean Highway. Soul Seeking Ministry, Moores Island. Crossing Rocks Primary School, Crossing Rocks. Assemblies of God Church, Cherokee Sound, for the Island of Acklands. Lovely Bay Primary School, Lovely Bay. Snug Corner Primary School, Snug Corner. Acklands Central High School, Pompey Bay. And Salina Point Primary School, Salina Point, for the Island of Andros Central District. St. Bartholomew Anglican Church, Bearing Point, Andros. Church of God, Cargill Creek. Pentecostal Church, Bowen Sound. New Highway Pentecostal Church, Blanket Sound. Pentecostal Church, Love Hill, Queens Highway.
The natural resources of the Bahamas play a critical role in supporting Bahamian livelihoods. For example, the fishing and tourism industry, which include fishermen, seafood exporters, hoteliers, dive operators, restaurants, and others. Collectively, they generate approximately $1.5 billion a year. Therefore, we must respect and preserve what we have. These resources belong to us.
This is my livelihood.
This is my livelihood.
This is my livelihood.
So let's all do our part to maintain our local economy and a good quality of life. Remember, if we take care of nature, nature will take care of us.
Drivers hit the road at the crack of dawn. It's expected to be a complement to the transportation system, which was severely impacted by the health crisis. Now, while buses are operating, they're doing so under new measures. Charles Fisher is checking out the situation.
Yes, good morning, Makushla. Good morning, Bahamas. The bus drivers are definitely back on the road this morning. We are here on Bay Street, joined by two bus drivers. First, give me your name.
Tyrone Major.
Pledge Martin.
How has it been so far, first day back?
Well, it's slow. You know, people haven't really known that the buses have returned to the streets, and it's been slow, so we're just taking it 1 minute at a time until everybody get their viewers back together and everything, and just be taking the bus again. So,
were the early passengers following the protocol, sanitizing, seeing what they're supposed to say?
Basically, yes. Like I said, it was slow, so they had an open bus to sit where they choose to sit. So it wasn't like it was jam packed and they didn't know where to do or what, you know, the sanitizing process. They wore their masks and that's basically it. But, you know, like I said, it's a very slow morning.
Hopefully things will pick up as the day goes along.
As the days and into the next week, you know, hopefully.
And you had to go a long way. You went out to Lyford Key this morning, and you were telling me just three passengers.
Really, I went out to Mount Pleasant. And I had three, I take three passengers down, one on the $20 bill, she gone free, another one on the $10 bill, that one gone free because we, you know, we trying to eliminate giving back the change. And then the other one, she had a correct change. So I only make a $2.50.
So you want to encourage passengers when you're coming in, please bring the correct change.
Please bring the correct change, yes, because we wouldn't have any change to be given back.
Mm-hmm. And right now all the bus drivers are here just glad to be back out though.
Oh, it's a great feeling. Like I say, it's a great feeling to be back, you know, being home, doing nothing. I mean, I feel like I was going crazy. But now I'm back on the road. I mean, right now, I know things are slow. And, I just want to be out, just to come to work to have something to do, because I'm not used to being home, just laying down, you know.
And like he's indicating, good to be back among your brothers and your fellow bus drivers.
Yeah, just having fun and doing what we do best, you know, and just helping out the basic people that need bus transportation.
So the buses are definitely back on the road. Please bring correct change, follow protocol, sanitize, and sit where you are supposed to. Downtown Nassau for the Morning Edition. Back to you, Makushla.
Well, thanks, Charles. Taxi drivers also back to work. They are expected to be operating from LPIA and catering to both foreign and domestic services. For the past several weeks, the taxi drivers and operators have been readying themselves when domestic travel resumed. Today, their client numbers will increase with the arrival of international guests. Union President Wesley Ferguson says the big day comes following much preparation and dialogue.
We have several meetings with NAD and Mandan has joined the lockdown, and we're all on the same page. We've all collaborated with each other. We met and we agreed what the new protocols was going to be. So taxi drivers are ready and they're poised to go because all they basically need is so far to start working is make sure their badge is up to date. They have insurance. The cars are cleaned and sanitized. They have their sanitizing solutions. They already have their masks. Already ready to go. And of course, they are practicing socialized distancing. Of course, we don't expect to have a busy, busy day. But however, whatever comes up, we are ready and able to take on the task.
Hoping for improved business, Ferguson says they understand the climate brought on by the pandemic.
Everybody, as far as I can find, is welcome to try their hands at the airport and see what the end result is going to be. Well, so far it's been up and down. It's been smooth. Taxi drivers don't have any complaints because they realize that we are still in the pandemic. So there are certain measures that were put in place that they would have to adhere to. And they've been acting pretty sensibly. So, the only challenge that they have basically sometimes it's a very slow day. And, you might get one fare sometimes, some taxi drivers complained on not having any fares, but that was expected because we are only so far receiving domestic travelers. So with the international travelers along with domestic travelers, we looking to have a bit better opportunity for them to take home something to their families.
Well, the U.S. top infectious disease expert just yesterday warned that the COVID-19 pandemic is out of control in some places there, with possibility of reaching 100,000 cases a day. In fact, Anthony S. Fauci admitted that he's not even satisfied with what's going on because the United States is going in the wrong direction. That's the grim reality the Bahamas is up against as it reopens its borders. Many here at home wonder then why even do so, risking new infections, hospitalizations, and even deaths. It's a concern the Prime Minister sought to quell during his televised address this past Sunday.
We are reopening because we must carefully balance the health, economic, and social needs of our people in order to secure our country in the medium and long term. We have to reopen to get more Bahamians back to work and to get businesses and the economy back to work. Like a number of other countries, we are reopening because we have been successful in arresting the community spread of COVID-19 in the Bahamas.
And for those who refuse to cooperate, or as the Prime Minister put it, frustrate best efforts, came this appeal.
As we seek to open up our economy and restore our society, let us remember that it is about preserving the health of our people. It is about saving precious lives. It is also a good thing for our future economic prospects, because if we can maintain our reputation of having handled the pandemic well, and then that in itself will attract visitors to our shores. Let us take traditional Bahamian civility to a new level. Let us take Bahamian patriotism to a new level. We must be responsible as individuals, but we also have a social responsibility to others.
The Bahamas Paradise Cruise Line operator of Bahamas Celebration gets the go-ahead to head back on the waters, as Atalia Hall tells us, this, of course, having met several guidelines.
This approval means that Bahamas Paradise Cruise Line, the operators of Bahamas Celebration, has complied with the Center for Disease Control and Prevention's requirements under its no-sail order and is providing a safe environment for crew members to work and disembark. To receive this approval, the Bahamas Paradise Cruise Line met several guidelines. No confirmed cases of COVID-19 for the past 28 days. Crew members must come from a ship that had no confirmed cases of COVID-19 for 28 days. Land-based crew who embarked must have been immediately quarantined for 14 days. Cruise lines must submit signed attestation of commercial travel. According to the Director of Port and Terminal Operations at Bahamas Paradise Cruise Line, Lisa Schilling, navigating the difficult waters of COVID-19 has been a challenge that the cruise industry has faced with grace. And the company is excited to be the first to receive the CDC's approval on their no-sail response plan. The company has already implemented new and improve health and safety guidelines on board, and knows that while cruising will look a bit different, they are doing everything possible to ensure a safe, healthy, and memorable vacation experience. Schilling adds that the Bahamas Paradise Cruise Line looks forward to providing guests with quality service as they move into the new normal that lies ahead. Now, the wide range of health and safety measures that were recently implemented include embarkation to disembarkation, keeping guests and crew members safe and healthy. The new protocols include closing two passenger stateroom decks to reduce crowds on board, requiring all terminal staff to wear masks and remain behind safety plexiglass to minimize contact with guests, suspension of self-service buffet stations, keeping tables and seating areas 6 feet apart, reducing tour buses for excursions to 50% capacity, mandatory temperature screenings for all guests, and more. It's Halia Hall, ZNS Network News.
Well, Super Club Breezes, the only resort opening today on the Cable Beach Strip. Officials have put in place a number of new measures and made numerous adjustments for this big day. Our Lloyd Allen is at the resort.
Well, good morning, McCushla, and good morning, Bahamas. It's a great day. Of course, we know across the country, many Bahamians are preparing for the arrival of visitors back to the country. And one of those major resorts here in the country that is welcoming and opening its arms to those visitors is Breezes Spa and Super Clubs in the Cable Beach District. I'm speaking this morning with the managing director, Mona Issa, who is very excited and on the ground getting things started. Good morning and welcome to the Morning Edition.
Morning and morning, Bahamas.
So it's been a long time coming. Tell us about some of those things that you were hoping for leading up to the day.
Well, I was hoping we'd have more occupancy today, but hey, it is what it is. We start small. You have to walk before you can run. So we're happy with the four guests that we have checking in today, and we're hoping by the end of the month that things will pick up.
So you have four guests coming in today, but I know obviously over the last several weeks you've also been doing a lot of lending of yourself, so to speak, to the wider Bahamian public. We know some persons were here during the quarantine period. Talk to us about that experience.
It was our pleasure to step in when asked by the government. As you can see, we're in the new Cabadista that we've renamed from the Overlook. But effectively, the quarantine facility was to our right. And it was boarded off, so everyone had to stay on that side. But it was our pleasure to step in once the call came from the Prime Minister's office.
And I know also, Makushla, we have this morning the hotel manager who was talking a little bit about how employees have been prepped leading up to today and really assisting them with helping those guests and maintaining social distancing. Good morning. Tell us your name again and what levels of preparation have you made for guests and employees leading up to today?
Well, good morning, Bahamas, and thank you for having me. We have, according to the Bahamas tourism plan, we have done extensive training with our employees. In addition to that, we've had the opportunity to set up some of our service areas who will be taking care of our guests. We set up the service area with barriers, PPEs for our employees. We're also doing pre-screening for the employees. And they're excited to welcome our guests back, and we're excited. And as you pan the beach has been set up for social distancing also. So we're excited to have the first guests in-house today. We look forward to it.
Now, in line with employees, of course, they would have been out for a while. Were there any employees here during the time, and are they as excited as you guys are in being back?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. There were employees here at the time. Mm-hmm. They are excited to continue on, and we just brought back some more employees, and we're excited to have them back. They're trained, they're ready, and it's all about the business of taking care of our guests. So.
Well, that sounds beautiful. Now, Mona, it's a beautiful day. We're under the Cabanista. One of those things that we talked about off camera was really preparation toward guests coming into the country and finding activities to do. You want to shed some light on that?
Well, we have had to redo our whole entertainment program because there are certain games you can't do without physically touching something. So we're going to have a lot of trivia, dance class, water aerobics, volleyball in the pool because the chlorine should sanitize the ball. So, and then what we're very lucky about, we can have walks on the beach. We have 1,000 feet of beach. It's around 100 feet deep, 800 guests if we're ever at capacity. Hopefully that'll be sooner rather than later. So I think that's around 13 square feet per guest. So we have a lot of space for social distancing on prime land. So they can do walks on the beach. We have a lot of space out there. Very excited.
I don't know, one of those things that a lot of local facilities has been doing to really welcome the local patronage from our locals as well is really adjusting pricing and making special discounts for them available. Is Breezes doing something similar as well?
Yes. We have a special for July and August for the local market, $200 a night for two people in the room. Come on down and fill us up.
Yes, yes, yes. We're ready. I think the employees are, again, excited about coming back. And we have about 15% of our employees back now, and they're actively working. And so they're ready. We're ready.
And the more that the locals come and fill us up, the more team members we can bring back home. So we need your support.
Wow, and support is definitely on the table today. But, of course, reporting here ahead of those four guests that are arriving today at Breezes, Lloyd Allen for the Morning Edition.
Thank you very much.
Lloyd, when we return, your plastic items are no more. The details coming up.
Fed me, naked you clothed me. They will know us by our love.
Can't imagine how it felt as you lay there, through the dark, through the heat, through the cold, with your friend by your side, held his hand and watched him die, and you cried as you prayed for his soul.
I can't imagine how it felt as you stood there, through the winds that would just not go away. Kiss my wife, tell my son, my work on earth is done. You're the one that can still hear them say, oh.
Is there anybody
False bottom, because they look empty to me.
Not for long. You taking a shopping right now.
For what?
Things you're gonna need in case you can't get out of your house after a natural disaster.
We know when we had a hurricane around here.
That's it. We get too lax. It ain't only hurricane, you know, we gotta worry about, you know. You know, we could have tsunami or we could have earthquake. You know, they don't give you no time to go shopping.
What kind of earthquake?
Scientists just find 149 over there by Lake Guana. And even though they say it's stationary, it there. So we need to go and get our survival kit.
Like what?
What you mean, like what? Plastic bag to put your important papers in. Like water, medication, flashlight, radio, canned goods, things you need. Things you might need, just in case you can't get out of your house after a natural disaster. These two plastic containers, the children them could paint them up in their special colors so they could know what they're looking for when you send them to look for it.
That's one thing I like about you. You always ready.
What I love most about working for the Bahamas Tonight is that we don't only focus on New Providence. We cover the entire Bahamas. We have a team here in the Northern Bahamas that is ready to bring you the stories, the people, and the news that matter to you. From point A to Z, from covering hurricanes to elections and everything in between.
Has given the okay to establish a COVID enforcement unit whereby individuals will assist the relevant agencies in ensuring Bahamians and residents comply with COVID-19 protocols and procedures.
And they and us, Mr. Speaker, are taking this matter very serious, and regardless to whom the individuals may be they visitors, residents, or citizens, if they are in violation of our laws, they will be dealt with properly. I do not want to call any restaurant or nightclub names, but that particular nightclub in the East know whom I'm speaking about. And be assured, if we see that happening again, what has happened just recently, they will be dealt with properly. And the same message goes out to two restaurants in the West. I need not call their names, but they know one is east of me and one is west of me, and I live tropical. So one is to my left and one is to my right. They know whom they are. And if they continue to behave in that manner, they too will be closed.
Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Dr. Hubert Minnis also issued a warning to Family Islanders.
Exuma, Harbor Island, Eleuthera, Long Island, and other islands who do very well with respect to boating. There'll be many yachts visiting your shores, and we must be very vigilant and ensure that those visitors wear their masks and we wear our masks. We must also ensure, and the authorities will be there, to ensure that they comply with our laws and they present a COVID-negative testing before they enter our shores or whatever amendments are made to certain countries that may not have COVID facilities available.
Detectives now juggling two homicides within the same day, just 7 hours after crime scene investigators were called to St. Joseph's Cemetery, Boyd Road, came news of a similar tragedy off Bellot Road. Police tell us a man was repairing a vehicle in front of a home on Pink Meadows Avenue when a gunman showed up and opened fire, shooting him before running off in an unknown direction. The victim died there on the scene. COVID-19 taking quite a toll on the balance sheets of private schools. With a new semester set to begin in a matter of months, the education minister concedes that the government may have to do some things to keep those schools going while making overall adjustments to ensure such environments are safe for students to return. Cleopatra Murphy has the details.
Private schools will likely see an increase in their subventions as government moves to support those institutions in the upcoming school year. The COVID-19 pandemic has led to unemployment in the double digits, with Minister of Labor, Senator the Honorable Dion Folks, predicting that it could be as high as 40%, while some 55,000 Bahamians had filed for unemployment benefits up to early June. This circumstance could spark an exodus from some private institutions and lead to increased enrollment in government schools. Minister of Education, the Honorable Jeff Lloyd, says the public school system is prepared for increased numbers, but government is also making interventions to assist cash-strapped schools.
We are also providing assistance for those schools that have found themselves, you know, disadvantaged as a result of COVID-19. That means additional financial support. That support is going to take the form, I believe, of at least two applications. One, an immediate injection, potentially to assist those who have struggled as a result of non-payment of fees or whatever else, and they have to maintain their staff, and possible increases in subvention for those schools, again, who demonstrate that their circumstance requires government's assistance in that regard.
Lloyd says the fact is the educational system cannot operate efficiently without the private sector because public schools can only absorb a finite number of students.
We do not in the Ministry of Education have the physical space to absorb 70 plus thousands of students. We now have 46 and the rest of it is in the private sector. So we naturally need to have the private sector pay a role and the government needs to support it. To what form that support will take, as I indicated, could also be in terms of one-time injection as well as an increase in subvention. And that subvention this year is to total some $15 million.
The COVID-19 pandemic provides further challenges for the wider school system, including public schools, where the Minister of Education says further adjustments will have to be made to accommodate social distancing and other requirements. He says several options are being considered for the 2020-2021 school year, and that may include more reliance on virtual learning.
We're aggressively looking at it and also consulting with our stakeholders. But it does certainly require that if we are going to have to maintain physical distance of 6 feet, and if we are going to be fair to the citizens of our country, the students in particular, then some form of rotation, shifts, or whatever you want to call it, is going to have to be implemented. And when I say blended, it means that some face-to-face, if it's only a part of the day or part of the week, along with the virtual engagement, the virtual school.
Cleopatra Murphy, ZNS Network News.
Wave goodbye to plastic items. They're to be permanently removed off the shelves. The nationwide ban on single-use plastic bags, plastic straws, plastic utensils, and styrofoam containers and cups took effect at midnight. The Bahamas joined several other countries in the movement to eliminate plastics in January of this year. On Tuesday, store owners were busy removing items which fall under the Forbidden Four category off their shelves. Although they've been preparing, owner at Darvel's Packaging, Darnell Darvel, said changing over hasn't been easy and the company's bottom line was affected. Still, she's pleased to know they're doing their part in helping to protect the environment.
Well, we have been preparing for the plastic ban since the government put it in effect. We wish we would have had more time to get rid of the plastic bags. Since COVID-19, we were out of business. And we wish they wouldn't have given, retailers charge for the plastic bags, because then we would have been able to, you know, sell more as well. We're fine with it. You know, it's going to be better for the environment. We don't have a problem with that. We're adjusting. We're changing over.
Well, a number of store owners believe the timeline should have been extended, especially since the country was locked down for more than 2 months due to the pandemic. However, Dr. Rhianna Neely, head of the Climate Change Unit at the Ministry of Environment, says companies were given sufficient time to make the necessary adjustments.
This has been over 2-year journey with the stakeholders. We've been meeting with business owners. We've been meeting with the general public. We've been meeting with government agencies, your customs, Department of Environmental Health Services. We've been meeting with many of the importers so that they understand what's going on. And many of them are very happy and appreciative of the ban. They understand the reasons behind the ban. So they have been supportive and assisting us with the full implementation so far.
You're watching The Morning Edition. More to come after the break.
For generations, Bahamians, visitors, and international customers have enjoyed the luscious taste of the Bahamian spiny lobster. The spiny lobster is the most lucrative marine resource in the Bahamas that supports a profitable fishing industry, generating millions of dollars annually and providing employment for thousands of Bahamians. Though the lobster fishery seems stable, threats impacting this fishery still exist, including illegal harvesting of undersized lobsters and harvesting during the close season. To address some of these threats impacting lobster populations, a lobster fishery improvement project is being implemented. In order to sustain the country's lobster populations and secure Bahamian livelihoods, all stakeholders must work together and participate in efforts such as the Lobster Fishery Improvement Project to help better manage our fishery.
I would like to encourage all Bahamian stakeholders to promote and support legal harvesting and purchasing of lobsters. If we expect to benefit from our marine resources well into the future, we must take action now and make the necessary changes to protect our way of life.
I think all Bahamians should support the Fisheries Improvement Project. It helps to strengthen the management process for our fisheries.
Influenza, or the flu as it is commonly called, is a viral illness that usually occurs between the months October to March. The virus is transmitted from person to person through coughing, sneezing, or talking. Symptoms include fever, cough, headache, runny nose, generalized body aches, and fatigue. There is no specific treatment for the flu, and the symptoms usually dissipate after 3 to 7 days. Because it is caused by a virus, antibiotics are not used to treat the flu. Persons are encouraged to rest and drink lots of fluids. Panadol is recommended for fever and body aches associated with the flu. However, aspirin should be avoided due to the risk of bleeding. To decrease the spread of flu, persons are encouraged to get their flu shot annually and practice good cough hygiene. Additional information can be provided by your community clinic or the Health Education Division at the Ministry of Health. This message is brought to you by the Ministry of Health in partnership with the Public Hospitals Authority.
One of the things with Ill Ability's mission is to empower individuals to live life with limitless possibilities through positive interactions within communities worldwide.
There are many people around the world, able-bodied and differently abled, who have doubts, who lack confidence, who aren't sure what they want to do with their lives, or don't think that they can do what they would like to do, what they dream of doing. And we try to show them that if you have a dream and you stop making excuses for yourself as to why you cannot or should not pursue your dream or your passion, then there are no limits to what you can achieve.
Like when someone sees my dance, I want them to see the message that no matter what obstacles they're faced with, they can always find a way to do it their own way.
Independence will certainly mean something different this year due to ongoing concerns about the global health threat. Independence Committee members say families will not be able to gather at Clifford Park, but will instead have to tune into the ZNS News Network to watch a virtual Independence broadcast. Committee Chairman and MP for Fort Charlotte, Mark Hume, says that broadcast will still feature well-loved Independence traditions.
This Independence will be the first time in our nation's history that Bahamians will not be able to gather in mass for celebrations on Bay Street, Government House, or historic Clifford Park. the site of every major independence celebration, from the downing of the Union Jack to the raising of the black, aquamarine, and gold flag in 1973. That mere change makes this independence a somber yet momentous occasion.
Now, during the virtual celebration, tribute will be paid to Bahamians who lost their lives in Hurricane Dorian and COVID-19. Local entertainers and other native elements will also be featured.
This made-for-television independence special will be in keeping with that tradition and will feature a star-studded cast of young Bahamian sketch artists who are making their splash all over social media, including YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and TikTok. This year's production, entitled Pressing Onward, will feature performances from Bahamian talent, including Latoya Dean and Shaneo Sarge Newbold out of Grand Bahama, Dasque, Miss Priceless Wood, Cookie and Hope, Solo, Dynamite Daisy, Stephen Hanna, and many more.
Well, after months of home exercise, fitness gurus are able to get back in the gym starting today. Jay Philippe takes a closer look.
Gym goers will finally get a chance to return to their workout spots. One of the major fitness facilities on the island is making final preparations for reopening. As of July 1st, GB Fitness will be open for business from 5:30 a.m. to 8 p.m.
When you first come into the gym, you gotta be wearing your mask. When you come to sign in at the desk, you're gonna sanitize, sign in, swipe in. We're gonna take your temperature. And then you proceed inside the gym with your workout. Now you're gonna have to bring two towels. You're gonna have to bring one for your face and your hands and one to put between you and the machine.
Wiley says you can expect some changes at the gym when they reopen.
We will be restricting our numbers. It's just gonna really be a play by ear at the time. If people can try and come at like our usual quiet times, especially the people that aren't working, come at a different time of the day. Apart from that, it's going to be just watching that people don't get into big crowds, and there's a whole lot of people gathering. Aerobics will have to be, our aerobic room is really big too, so once everything's spread out, we should be okay and good to go with that.
Fitness trainer Glenn Stubbs says they have spaced out gym equipment and will limit the number of people to be present in fitness classes.
We had the lockdown now going on 3-4 months, and a lot of persons in the community has gained some weight. I've seen some clients out there in the community, you know, so just time to get active again, get moving again, get your body program again, and, you know, it relieves stress, you know, keep you healthy, and give you an outlook. You know, we live in Grand Bahama, you know, this community, the economy, so exercise is one way we can fight against that, you know.
I'm Jay Philippe, ZNS Network News.
Well, that alone should get you in the workout mood, and for that, we turn to none other than Natasha Brown.
Come on down, Natasha Brown has got you with the ultimate fitness.
Hi, good morning. It is another downtown segment, and I've got the ultimate team. I've got Francesca, Stacy, Tino, Denevio, Chanton. And let me tell you, we've got 5 minutes of just movement for you. Do the thing you have been afraid to do. Do that thing that you have been afraid to do. Let's get right into the session. All right. Remember, even though we've got 5 minutes of just movement, we have to start stretching. And a lot of the stretches that we are going to be doing, the stretches are going to prepare us for the movement. So now we're just gonna touch, alternating toe touches right here, making sure we're keeping the back straight. Awesome. Now we're gonna bring it up, take it over the head so that we are getting the arms, the upper body ready. Now we're gonna bring the feet together. We're gonna go ahead and touch the toes right here. And remember, for the sake of time, you wanna do your stretches for about 20 to 25 seconds and do about 5 to 6 different stretches. Okay, we're gonna step back as far as we can. The left foot. Bring both hands inside. Ready, switch. Come back up. take the right foot all the way down and hold it here. Okay, our first exercise, we're gonna start off with our 8 skips. And we're gonna start right here. Now, for the sake of time, I want you to go ahead and you're gonna do each exercise about 30 reps, which could be for 1 minute. So bring the knees all the way up. So we got 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hold it right here. So now we're gonna go down and we're gonna take it. Actually, we're gonna stay standing for this one. We're gonna place the hands right here to the sides. What we're gonna do is sit back into the good morning, all the way down and come back up. We're gonna take it as low as you can, keeping your face parallel to the floor and your back straight. So we're gonna do 10 of these. This is 10, 9, and this is how you should look. 8 right here, 7, keeping the core nice and tight, 6, 5, awesome team, 4, right here, 3, awesome, 2, and 1. Now we're gonna take it down to kneeling push-ups. Now you're gonna see a variety of different push-ups. You must follow the one that addresses your fitness level. Ready, go. 10, 9, 8, awesome. 7, 6, 5, 4, looking good. 3, 2, and 1. Let's get up. Now we've got prisoner squats for 10. Ready, go. 10, keep that head up. 9, keep that back straight. 8, the tummy is tight. 7, looking good. 6, that's it. 5, 4, 3, good job. 2, and 1. Now we're gonna take it into downward dog and plank. Ready, 4, 3, 2, push, go. Downward dog, that's 1. Downward dog, 2. Looking good. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Beautiful. Take it up. Now we're going into side lunges. Go ahead and straddle your feet a little wider than the shoulders, and you're gonna sit back into your heels. It's very important that you're not pushing your knee forward, you're sitting into the side. For 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. Our final movement exercise is just side jumps for 10. Let's go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Remember, go and do that thing that you are afraid of. Step out. If the branch breaks, break, fall down with it, but get up. Until next time, I am Downtown Natasha Brown, keeping you healthy, fit, and energized. I am the ultimate me.
Ministry of Social Services and Urban Development, Department of Social Services, presents a list of 2020 official hurricane shelters. For the island of Andros, Mangrove Key, Burnt Rock Primary, Burnt Rock, Mangrove Key High School, Mangrove Key, St. Peter's Baptist Church, Mangrove Key. For the island of Andros, Southern District, Euthal Rogers Primary School, Deep Creek, Mount Olive Baptist Church, Smith's Hill, Friendship Baptist Church, The Bluff, Cleola McKenzie Preschool, Long Bay, South Andros Senior Citizens Home, Camps Bay, St. Robert's Catholic Church, High Rock. For the island of Andros, Northern District, B.A. Newton Primary School, Red Bays, Clara Evans Primary School, Nicholstown, Bamsey Building, Bar Community, First Baptist Church, San Andros, Church of God of Prophecy, North Mastic Point, Berry Islands, Great Harbor Key, Church of God of Prophecy, Bullocks Harbor. For the island of Bimini, Gateway Gymnasium, Bailey Town, and Bimini United Burial Society Hall, Alice Town. For the island of Cat Island, St. Mark's Anglican Church, Port Howe, Zion Baptist Church, McQueen's, Zion Baptist Church, Old Bite, Mount Sinai Baptist Church, New Bite, Holy Redeemer Roman Catholic Church, New Bite, Lovely Zion Baptist Church, The Bluff, Seaview Seventh-day Adventist Church, Wilson Bay, St. Andrew's Episcopal Church, Arthur's Town.
Hey, long time no see.
You hear me?
Long time no see.
Boiled fish, stewed fish, stewed conch, I love it all.
Tourists come here to take our tours, experience our sun, sand, and sea, and they also spend money around town.
I used to see a bunch of hogfish around here, but nowadays, I hardly see any.
You protect one area, the fish do they think, make a bunch of babies, that spread all over the sea. What's the problem?
If we protect certain parts of our sea, it keeps all parts working right.
I was against that fish, but knowing what I know now, I totally agree. Having marine protected areas.
I support marine protected areas.
We support marine protected areas.
Look for Bahamas Protected on Facebook.
Sign the petition. Sign the petition.
This weather report is sponsored by Bank of the Bahamas, the Bank of Solutions.
That's our broadcast this morning. We invite you to tune in with us this Monday, July 6th for our new morning edition time. And that's at 6:30 a.m. to 7:30. The new morning edition time again beginning next Monday. From all of us here, have a wonderful day.
It sure was the stars above. What goes up must come down. Here's a man.